In the 1920s, the nation's weekly attendance to movies equaled an astounding 50%. As no other widely available and equally cheap public source of entertainment existed, people of all ages rushed into the movie theaters. The weekend provided families the opportunity to go out to the movies and enjoy the day's most popular form of entertainment. With movie theaters charging a mere nickel or dime to attend films, attendance soared during the Great Depression of the late 20s and early 1930s. Before the enactment of the Motion Picture Production Code, there weren't any official restrictions or regulations concerning the content that could be displayed in American motion pictures. Explicit material such as nudity, drugs, violence, and vulgarity were commonplace in many American films. Audiences had developed an appetite towards this content. Hollywood had attracted several controversial movie makers that would introduce a lot of very risque subject matters into their films, in turn feeding this appetite of the public and making films that created enormous revenue for their studios. As explicit movies continued to be developed, conservative members of society began to harbor the fear that explicit content in these films would have a detrimental effect on American society, especially on the children. The rise of the film industry created exciting and sensationalist tabloids and magazines that reported on the lives of rebellious celebrities who frequently clashed against the conservative norms of society. Religious vanguards and other moral conservatives began to protest the obscenities and indecencies present in films. The most important actions they took were in petitioning Congress and then the several bills that were brought up in an attempt to censor films. In one of the biggest decisions of the early 20th century, Mutual Film Corporation v. Industrial Commission of Ohio, the Supreme Court set a precedent for censorship in the movie industry, unanimously declaring that First Amendment rights did not extend to motion pictures. This landmark case led to the institution of censorship boards across the nation, especially in the conservative South. The threat of government intervention and censorship was strong enough to scare the major studios into forming the Motion Picture Producers and Distributors of America, otherwise known as the MPPDA, in order to enact decency standards. In 1930, these would all be collected into the Motion Picture Production Code, or the Hays Code, named after the first president of the MPPDA, William Harrison Hays, a former Republican committee chairman and Presbyterian elder who had been hired to clean up Hollywood. In the words of the Hays Code, the purpose of the code was to govern the making of talking, synchronized, and silent motion pictures. The creators of the code recognized the important influence film had on numerous aspects of society. It was their moral obligation to ensure that entertainment was wholesome and pure. In the words of the code, no picture shall be produced that will lower the moral standards of those who see it. Hence, the sympathy of the audience should never be thrown to the side of crime, wrongdoing, evil, or sin. The Hays Code can be essentially divided into two different parts. The first part details the importance of the movie industry on the lives of countless Americans and the moral obligations they must follow. The second part is a long list of rules and regulations stating exactly what are prohibited from being displayed on the big screen. Under the Hays Code, movie scripts were sent to the Hays office to be accepted, edited, for code approval, or rejected. Only producers such as Howard Hughes and Otto Preminger dared to challenge the Hays Code in the first years of its tenure. Hughes' film The Outlaw and Preminger's film The Moon is Blue were the first true tests of just how effective the code would turn out to be.
The first section of the code details the regulation of crime in American films. According to the code, the technique of murder must be presented in a way that will not inspire imitation. Brutal killings are not to be presented in detail. Revenge in modern times shall not be justified. In addition, illegal drug trafficking must never be presented, and theft, robbery, safe-cracking, and dynamiting of trains, mines, buildings, etc. should not be detailed in method. The most important principle under the category of sex declared, the sanctity of the institution of marriage and the home shall be upheld. Pictures shall not infer that low forms of sexual relationship are accepted or common thing. Scenes of passion were not to be introduced unless essential to the development of the plot, and lustful kissing was not to be shown under any circumstances. Sexual relationships between the white and black races were strictly forbidden under the code, as were scenes of childbirth and sex hygiene. Under the categories of obscenity and profanity, any type of curse word or vulgar expressions were deemed inadmissible for usage in movies. Also, under the costume category, complete nudity was forbidden and strictly warned against. Undressing scenes and indecent exposure were also to be avoided under the Hays Code. All of these various rules and regulations were under strict effect from 1934 to 1968, but the changing times reflected a growing sense of desire among the American public and filmmakers alike to reform the Hays Code.
What factors led to the eventual demise of the seemingly invincible Hays Code? Towards the end of its tenure, in the late 50s and early 60s, foreign films, not restricted by the Hays Code, became wildly successful in the United States. Vittorio De Sica's 1948 movie, Bicycle Thieves, and Ingmar Bergman's 1953 film, Samarin Mentonica, were among the successful foreign films running in American theaters. Since the movie industry had been found to have violated numerous antitrust laws, studios had to relinquish all ownership ties to the movie theaters, leading to numerous foreign films being presented in American theaters. In addition, the invention of the television posed a serious threat to the earlier dominance of the movie theater. In 1952, in the case of Joseph Burstein Incorporated versus Wilson, the Supreme Court overturned its earlier decision of 1950, declaring that motion pictures were indeed entitled to First Amendment protection.
Hollywood would continue to follow the code until the 1960s. The 1960s saw the rise of the countercultural or hippie movement that would be captured in music, books, and many other art forms. However, Hollywood films, with a very restrictive and conservative Hays Code in place, soon started to fall out of popularity, both with new film audiences and their makers. So over the decade, many filmmakers openly challenged the Hays Code in order to loosen its restrictions. One of the most important examples was Sidney Lumet's The Pawnbroker in 1964, which was the first film to have female nudity with code approval. Finally, once one movie with explicit content passed the Hays Code, a whole stream of movies followed close behind. The writing was on the wall, and in 1968, Jack Valenti, the then new president of the MPAA, finally got rid of the outdated code. In its place, he introduced the much less restrictive MPAA film rating system, which we now use today.
The film industry experienced a period of tremendous growth and prosperity during the early years of the 20th century. Accompanying this unprecedented growth and popularity were cries for reform and change in the movie industry. The Motion Picture Production Code of 1930 was an early attempt by the movie industry to evade government censorship by policing themselves. The creators of the code recognized the important influence films had on the numerous aspects of society. It was their moral obligation to ensure that all entertainment was wholesome and pure. Also, their duty was to cleanse both Hollywood and the movie industry. The Hays Code of 1930 was an important reform of the movie industry to both ensure its survival and incite the creation of the current MPAA rating system.
The code sets up high standards of performance for motion picture producers. It states the considerations which good taste and community value make necessary in this universal form of entertainment. Respect for law, respect for every religion, respect for every race, and respect for every nation.